It is wonderful to see you today on a rainy day. Happy Father's Day to all of you who bear that title, whether that's because of biological children or just because the way you have shared your love with others. So we thank you all and celebrate all of that. If you noticed and got concerned about barricades out here, we do have a large bike race in town that happens. I think when we're done, that 8th Street will still be open, but you can always leave, go out that side, and go on 9th Street on to there. I'm not quite sure when they. I think it was around 11-ish when they needed to kind of close off all of 8th Street. So don't be scared. You will not be stuck here. I'm sorry if that's a fear of yours, but so as we move through worship today, just some things to remind you of. Of course, our worship schedule, we're here for next Sunday, and then on the 30th, we will have our annual worship in the park. Union Park is just one block right over there. We'll be under the shade of the trees in the upper part of the park. There, you do have the ability to drive your car up there and drop someone off. The city just asked that we aren't supposed to park our cars up there, so if that means two of you need to get out, we will have some wonderful people that will then also pull your car back out to the street and bring it back up to you as you need. So don't let that be a concern that you're going to have to walk all that way or something. If it is raining, if it turns out to be a day like today, then just come here. So it's nice that it's only a block away, so you're not driving to completely different parts of town. So we have our Tuesday book study that we've been doing, Advancing Through Adversity, that Bev has been leading. So thank you for those of you who have been coming. I understand there's been some great conversations and things happening, and you're always welcome if that's something you'd like to do. On Thursday, we have our monthly Bible journaling that will be here at First Presbyterian at 6 o'clock. So again, that's been a great group that's been meeting. If it's something you want to try and haven't done it yet, now's a great time to do. It's never a wrong time to show up, learn a little techniques on how to maybe focus your reflections for a day or for a week or a period of time on some specific things, as well as doing some fellowship, both things which are good for the soul. On the 29th, we have our next park cleanup, and this time we're going to Red Arrow Beach and Park. So we would like to know if that is something that you are able to participate in. So if you are, just put your name on this list, because we pick up supplies from the city, and this lets us know how many folks are able to attend and to do that. So we'll just start that here. And you certainly don't have to be a member. You can invite any of your friends. You can invite family. Kids are welcome to participate as well. So it's just a nice time to be outside to help God's beautiful creation. And again, just to spend some time with each other and get to know each other. You'll be surprised what you talk about when you're picking up garbage. It's amazing what can happen. And then again, as I said, on the 30th, we have our worship in the park. That's at 10 o'clock. The church is providing the main course, and we invite you to bring a chair, a blanket, however you like to sit, and to bring some sort of a side dish or dessert. We'll also have basic utensils, but if you have your specific things you like, please bring those, and we will have some beverages too. And there are members from the community and a couple other faith communities around that are hoping to join us, at least for the picnic part at 11. We don't have to worry about providing everything for everybody. They are also coming for a potluck style picnic, just to meet up as a safe space for members of our community that don't always feel that they have those safe places to come. So our numbers may grow. That Sunday, we also have some special music from the guitar band at the Lakeshore Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. We'll be there and we'll play some things during worship, and then during the picnic we'll also just share some songs of hope and of justice. So it's a good time to celebrate. And I think that's all that we have for announcements today. So let's come together for a special prayer, a special litany for Father's Day. So if you are able, please stand. And let us join our voices responsively today as we celebrate all types of fathers. Our Lord Jesus Christ called God his heavenly Father and Joseph his earthly father. Let us come before our heavenly Father with our gratitude, praying for God's blessing and offering up all our experiences with our earthly fathers in prayer. Gracious God, we pray your blessing upon the fathers, stepfathers, adopted fathers, grandfathers of our lives. We pray for your blessings upon our uncles and brothers and mentors and friends who have been examples and role models. We pray for your strength for men who are tired and weary each day, yet feel the weight of responsibility upon them. We pray in gratitude for the fathers who have cared for us, protected us, and guided us, and taught us. We lift up the imperfections of our fathers, who tried the best they could, who did not know how to try, and who made mistakes along the way. We pray your blessing upon the men in our lives, that they will follow the example of Joseph, the father of Jesus, to live godly, creative, and loving lives. We bless you for the care we have received and ask that you will hold us in the totality and the complexity of our experience. We have known joy and care. We have known failure and pain. Turn our hearts to you that we might see you as our perfect heavenly Father, from whom all life freely flows. In the name of Jesus, who is with you and the Holy Spirit, lives and reigns one God in glory everlasting. Amen. So friends, we're going to sing a newer hymn today, though the tune will be familiar to you. This is When Jesus Called You Father. So Julie, why don't you just play through once so we all know, like, yep, we know that tune.
trust in you to guide us. Our lives are in your hands. Hold your children's future, it all will be made new. Your house has many dwellings, so we may live with you. Just like a loving Father, you answer when we pray. In thanks be to your children, now follow you each day.
Friends, I invite you to take some time now to greet one another, to welcome each other, to wish those who have it a happy Father's Day, and to remember that we are loved and worthy. May Christ's peace and love be with you all. It's always good to see you. Thank you very much. Happy Father's Day to you, Pete. So I saw Dan's post that he's talked to you. Thank you very much. Good to see you. Father's Day. All the young people want to join us up front, and those of you who are watching online, bring those young people particularly to watch at this time. And Brittany's got some special things for us. Here come some kids. All right, we got Spider-Man back again.
Good morning, my friends. Today's a really special day. What's today? Yes, it's Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all the dads and our father figures out there. We are continuing our summer theme, Questions Jesus Asked. So each week, we explore a different question that Jesus asked in the Bible that helps us think really deeply about ourselves and what we believe in. Today's question is going to come from Mark 5, where Jesus asks, "What's in your name?" So in our culture, many of us get our last names from our fathers. It's part of why their last names exist. It's like, you are the father of, but you're also. Mine is Pontius. So mine would be the father of Pontius. So it travels down and down and down and down and down. But what about our first names? I know we just had our greeting. We can do a little fun little mini activity. Ready? When I say go, I want you to turn to someone and you can give them a high five, a wave, a handshake, or a hug, and I want you to tell them your name. I heard a few people greet people by name, but I wonder if we know absolutely everyone's name. Are you ready? Set. Go.
I'm Matt. Perfect. My name didn't change. And you guys knew each other's names? Yeah. You say them 100 times a day? Yeah.
Perfect. Sometimes we might need things like name tags. We can use those to let people know our names. Jesus asked a man in the Bible, what is your name? Because he wanted him to know him better, and he wanted to help him. Knowing someone's name is just the first step in knowing them better and showing that you care. Names are really special, and they help us feel known and loved. Today, as we think about the question, what is your name? Let's all remember that Jesus even told us he knows each of our names. He cares about us deeply. Do you guys like to pray with me? Okay. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for knowing our names.
Thank you for knowing our names.
And loving us.
And loving us.
Help us to remember.
Help us to remember.
That we are important to you.
We are important to you.
Part of your family.
Part of your family.
And that we can show love.
That we can show love.
To others.
To others.
Amen.
Amen. That was a great prayer. Okay. We'll see you guys afterwards, okay?
So we prepare to hear God's word read and proclaimed today. Please pray with me. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voices but your own, so that we may hear your word and also do it. Through Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. So our scripture reading today comes from Mark's Gospel, and here we hear Jesus ask the question, what is your name? It's in an unusual context a little bit, but let's listen to this story. Jesus and his disciples came to the other side of the lake, to the region of the Gerasenes. As soon as Jesus got out of the boat, a man possessed by an evil spirit came out of the tombs. Now the man lived among the tombs, and no one was ever strong enough to restrain him, even with a chain. He had been secured many times with leg irons and chains, but he broke the chains and he smashed the leg irons. No one was tough enough to control him. Night and day, in the tombs and in the hills, he would howl and he would cut himself with stones. Now when he saw Jesus from far away, he ran and he knelt before him, saying, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? Swear to God that you won't torture me." He said this because Jesus had already commanded him, "Unclean spirit, come out of the man." Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" And he responded, "Legion is my name, because we are many." They pleaded with Jesus not to send them out of that region. Now there was a large herd of pigs that was feeding on the hillside. "Send us into the pigs," they begged. "Let us go into the pigs." Jesus gave them permission, so the unclean spirits left the man and went into the pigs. Then the herd of about 2,000 pigs rushed down the cliff into the lake and drowned. The word of the Lord. Well, this is an interesting story, isn't it? I mean, it ends on not a real high note, especially if you like bacon, right? That these pigs were possessed and ran off the cliff. I don't want to spend a lot of time in that area today. Instead, I want us to spend a little bit time just back up in the text a little bit. So we are studying the questions of Jesus, and what did Jesus ask? Well, and today's question seems rather straightforward, doesn't it? What is your name? I'm guessing most of us don't have a problem answering that question. I mean, it's a question, Kristen, that you probably ask on the first day of school with your students, right? I mean, we ask that often when we meet. I mean, our youngest in our midst seem to also be able to answer that simple question. What is your name? But it's not so easy when we begin to look at the complications of the world around us. In a world that seems to have taken away our divine name and given us a legion of other worldly names. So let's go back to the story. The story is always a good place to start. And Josh, my clicker doesn't seem to work. Do you have anything up there you can... There we go, now it's working. Okay, so our story begins. Jesus has sailed across the Lake of Galilee into the region of the Gerasenes. And there he is confronted by a possessed man who we're told lives out among the tombs in a cemetery, surrounded apparently by some pigs. Now let's unpack that story because there's a lot in here that we might miss. First is we have to understand what this Jewish world in the first century, what it means between being clean and unclean. To be clean means that you are working to fulfill the 613 laws that are laid out in what we know as the first five books, particularly in the books of Deuteronomy and Leviticus. 613 laws. To be clean means that you're following those, and if you misstep, there's rituals that are done so that can restore you to a state of cleanliness. To be clean means that you have the right to stand before God in prayer and in what was in the Old Testament in a sacrificial system as well. To be unclean, on the other hand, means that you have not been in accordance with the laws of Moses. And that could be because you accidentally broke them and then you're going to participate in the rituals that will bring you into a state of cleanliness. Or it could mean that you have chosen for one reason or another to not be in the circle of Israel, God's chosen people. No good Jew ever wants to be unclean. And the rules for being clean and unclean can be very specific. So keep that in mind, and now listen to some of the other things that this story tells us. So first, Jesus is in a boat, and he leaves the land of clean people. He leaves the Israel's land, and he goes across to the other side, to the territory of the Gerizines, the Gentiles, the non-Jews. Jesus leaves what is clean and goes to a land that is considered unclean. In doing so, Jesus himself becomes ritually, spiritually unclean. And then we're told that he meets a man that is possessed with evil spirits. Well, guess what? That's another category that makes you unclean. And then we're told that this man lives among the tombs. Now, there's not much more that is ritually unclean than a dead body. And so to live in the cemetery means that then this man is doubly unclean. And again, by Jesus coming into contact with this man, Jesus would be in a state of ritual impurity or unclean. And then, just in case we haven't gotten the message that Jesus is in an unclean area, we also get thrown into there that there is a herd of pigs around. Now, whether these were wild pigs or whether these were somebody's farming animals, we don't know. What we do know is that pigs are not a Jewish farming animal. They themselves are unclean. So Jesus is now four times unclean just by where he is at. He is surrounded by unclean. Now, the third thing that I want you to know, that this story tells us that Jesus still has power, even when he's four times unclean. Even when he is categorically, spiritually impure, in a state of impurity, Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, still has the power to work. So there's a whole nother lesson in there about God's power. But let's focus on Jesus in this particular moment. So Jesus steps off that boat into the unclean land, and the unclean man comes up to him, and they have a little conversation, and then Jesus asks our question of the day: what is your name? Now, the man doesn't seem to respond. He doesn't say, my name is Tobias, I'm Tom, I'm Dick or Harry. But instead, something else speaks and says, my name is Legion, for we are many. Legion, a word used to describe a company of soldiers, a certain amount of people. It is meaning that there are lots of different things going on with this man. The man answers not with a name that comes from God, but he answers with the name of an unclean one, of the unclean powers of the world, and says that we are legion, that we are many in here. The Presbyterian pastor and theologian Frederick Buechner once wrote this quote: if someone forgets my name, I feel it is I who am forgotten. If someone forgets my name, I feel as if it is I who am forgotten. I wonder if part of the struggles of this man in our story today is that he has been forgotten. That perhaps he himself has even forgotten his God-given name. The world, the people around him, his community gave him this name, Legion. They gave him a legion of names, and none of them were really who he was. To the world, he was a crazy man, he was a sick man, he was a village idiot, he was a scary man, he was a useless man. They gave him a legion of names that they would call him somehow to categorize him, to push them or push him away from their version of safety. He became the nameless man, just that crazy guy. They even tried to chain him down. They even tried to tie him down, but somehow, no matter how many names, a legion of worldly names they gave him, nothing really suited him. So I ask, do you know your name? Do you know your name, or do you only know the names that the world has given you? Something that our African-American siblings might call your slave name. Perhaps you remember that 1970s incredible miniseries called Roots. All through there was the constant returning early on that my name is not Toby, I am Kunta Kinte. We have this thing where the culture gives us a legion worth of names. They call us all sorts of things. And maybe that's the only name you know today. Maybe you only know your slave name, the name that others call you so they can pretend to have power over you, so they can pretend that they give you your purpose. And we forget our divine name. If you think, friends, if you think that among your names are the names of the dumb one, the ugly one, the fat one, the homeless one, the hungry one, then you need to hear Jesus calling out your new name, your real name. If you think your name is bad or addict or judger or cheater or selfish or unclean or sinner, then you need to hear Jesus call your real name. If you think your name is the rich one, the poor one, the Republican, the Democrat, the citizen, or the undocumented one, then you need to hear Jesus calling your real name. If you think your name is the sick one, the cancer one, the grieving one, the unworthy one, the heretic, the doubting, or the lost one, you need to hear Jesus call your real name. All those labels, all those names that the world will constantly put on us, those are our demon names. Those are the names of Legion. But that is not who you are. No, friends, none of those labels, none of those slave names, none of the legion of worldly demon names that people may have called you since you were knee-high to a church pew, none of those names are really who you are. You need to hear the real name that God has called you. Maybe you have not heard God's name for you in so long that you, like the man in Gerizim, could not remember. All he could remember were the labels that people had given him. Maybe you never really heard your godly name, but today, hear your name. Hear the name that God has given you. Your real name is my people, my child, my precious one. You were named by God as the forgiven, the graced, the loved, the saved, the worthy, the seen, the one who matters. That is the name that God has given you. You have been named child of God. That's who you are. No matter what you have done, no matter how big or bad your demons may seem, you are a child of God. You are not those things. You are not the labels of the world. You are God's child. And let me tell you, if Jesus has power in an unclean land, in an unclean man, in an unclean cemetery, surrounded by unclean pigs, if Jesus has the power to call forth the reality of who that man is, Jesus can call you, and you will know your real name. There is nothing, beloved congregation, that can ever separate us from the love of God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Powers, nor heights, nor principalities, even death itself will not separate us from God and the name that God has given us. Jesus takes flawed people a lot like you and me. God takes flawed and broken people. God takes Gerizim demoniacs. God takes all those people who are the lost sheep of the world. And I remind you that you all are only one step away from being a lost sheep. God has gathered us all together. And Jesus calls us out from the legions of the worldly demons that seek to put us down. And Jesus calls us who we really are, child of God. Friends, Jesus came to the place where you are, across the Sea of Galilee, across an intellectual divide, across the loneliness of a heart. Jesus has come to where you are and has said, what is your name? My prayer is that we will know that we are a child of God. My prayer is that we will always be able to answer the question, what is your name? And first and foremost, shout with our hearts and every other part of our being, I am a child of God. And then all the other things that you do will fall into place. Because remember, God made you a human being, not a human doing. We are human beings because we are the being, the child of God. So friends, what is your name? What is your name? Say it. We are a child of God. What is your name? What is your name? Amen. Our hymn now, Will You Come and Follow Me? the story of Jesus' calling. Jesus but calls our name, and we shall answer. If you are able, please stand and let us sing together.
Summer series of questions of Jesus, we're turning to the Heidelberg Catechism and looking backwards in our historic faith and answering questions on how the faith used to be taught. Today's question was about what is your name. One of the names that we are known by is Christian, which literally means the Christ One. So if you look in your bulletins, you see the question for today is question 32. It's also on the screen, but So I ask the question and you will provide the answer. But why are you called a Christian? Because through faith, a share in Christ, and thus his anointing, so that I may confess his name, offer myself a living sacrifice of gratitude to him, and fight against sin and the devil with a free and good conscience throughout this life, and hereafter rule with him in eternity over all creatures. Friends, as we have confessed, so let us live. Our name is Child of God, the Christ ones. Please be seated. Christ invites us to look beyond the names of this world. Christ calls us to come to the family table to break bread and to share the cup. Christ invites us to come just as we are, even if, like a man possessed in an unclean land, we may not always know our name. Jesus invites us to come and to feast at the table, for this is a table of the family of God. So no matter where you have been, this table is for you. And together, it is Christ's table for all the world. As we prepare to come to this table, as we prepare to share the bread and cup, it is fitting that we also take a moment to look at the gifts that we have already been blessed with and how we might share those gifts through our offerings. And so, friends, think about the needs of the world. Think about all those who are hungering and thirsting, those who still believe that the names the world has given them, the legions of names that tear down, they still believe that that is really their name. Let us share our gifts and our offerings this morning so that we may come to know, and they will come to know, their true name is a Child of God. This month, our special offering is for the Manitowoc Warming Shelter. If you are able to give above and beyond your regular offering to the work of Christ here, we will share that. And so just simply mark that for the warming shelter, and we will continue that ministry with the grace of God. I know there are prayers upon your hearts today. I come to you and ask for prayers for a member of our community, a family of our larger community here in Manitowoc, who had the tragic death of a 4-month-old child this week. Pray for that family that they may find some sense in the midst of what is truly a tragedy. I also want to clarify, a week or so ago, I invited you to pray for a Holly in our community that is living with cancer. I just want to clarify that is not Holly Johnson. But though I'm sure she has appreciated any prayers or things that you have offered, because we all need prayers, right? But it's a different Holly who is dealing with that cancer and who has ended her treatment time and just living life to its fullest. What other prayers do we come with today that we can name and share with each other? So Bill, would you like to share? Is that okay? Or you want me to? Okay. So Bill's brother-in-law passed away on Monday. And so we hold Bill and Mary and all of your extended family in our prayers. Other prayers today that we wish to name. It's exciting that, Julia, it's good to see you back after your procedure, and we're glad that your health is being restored. That's beautiful. Yes. Yes. Prayers for all the horrible violence that seems to continue, and gun violence in particular, that seems such an easy way for people to take out whatever emotions they may be feeling. Other prayers today? We remember the life of now my mind is going blank. Her funeral yesterday. This is where I need my notes. Yes, Irene Klinkert, thank you. Her service was yesterday. We continue to celebrate her life and playing the music for that service was one of our former musicians, Lloyd Goss, and Lloyd wanted me to share his joy with all of you and just thank you for keeping him in your prayers. He said, I'm still going at 88, still playing and singing. So we continue to pray for that. But friends, let us bring our hearts together in prayer. The Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts to the Lord our God, for it is right to give all God, to give all praise and thanksgiving to our God. Lord, we thank you that deep down under the layers of all the legion of names that this world has called us, all the labels that they placed upon us, all the burdens that they have put on us, that you still know our sacred name, that you have never forgotten who we are, even though we may have forgotten. And so continue to call out to us and let us hear you calling through the storms of life, through the chaos of life, calling to us, child of God, child of God. Lord, you have heard prayers that we have spoken today, prayers for hope, prayers for healing, prayers for the assurance of the resurrection and life eternal, prayers to end hatred and violence. Lord, send your spirit to every one of those places. Send your spirit through us to be in those places. Lord, we pray for those who have been healed, for those who are recovering, for those who are striving to uncover their name as a child of God. We pray for those who continue to be possessed by the legion of the pressures of this world. We pray that they may find the strength and the companionship to break free. We pray for our nation. Lord, you know how much we need your hope and your wisdom and your grace because we live in a broken world and our nation is not immune from that. As we hear the gentle and not so gentle rain fall, we think of those individuals who may continue on this bike race today, that you will keep them safe. We pray that you will keep those dry who have no roof over their head. Help us, Lord, to be your presence in this world. Again, we thank you for all the images, the positive images of fatherhood. Help us, Lord, to be the protectors, to be providers, to be the gentle souls to offer hugs and hope. And now, O Lord, let us bring our voices together and let us pray with one voice the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, this table has been prepared before us. It is a table in which God says, "Come, my precious child." It is not a table set because you're perfect or because I'm perfect. It's a table set because God is perfect. And God wants to share that perfected love with each and every one of us. So the invitation is to come to the table and to share. So this morning, to help me serve, Jim, will you be willing to come and to be a server this morning? What? No. You are invited to come, to bring your offerings, to lay them in the plate, and then to take the bread, to dip it in the cup, and to celebrate that God has called your name, that you are a child of God. If you are unable to come forward after others have been served, we will invite you to raise your hand. And we will come and we will bring the bread and the cup to you. For these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us feast. And remember, you are a child of God. Body of Christ and the cup of salvation given for you. Rejoice. Honey, the body of Christ and the cup of salvation for you. Rejoice. Carol, Christ's body for you. The cup of God's love for you. Lynn, the body of Christ and the cup of salvation. Body of Christ, the cup of salvation, remember your name. Fill the body of Christ, the cup of salvation, celebrate your name, child of God. Connie, the body of Christ, and the cup of salvation given for you. Kristen, the body of Christ, and the cup of salvation. Child of God. Receive the body of Christ and the cup of salvation. Rejoice, child of God. Julia, this is the body of Christ and the cup of salvation. Remember your name. You are a child of God. Tara, the body of Christ and the cup of salvation. Remember you are a child of God. Joanne, body of Christ and the cup of salvation. Remember that you are a child of God. Carry the body of Christ and the cup of salvation. Rejoice and remember you are a child of God. Are there any who are unable to come forward? Holy and gracious God, thank you for calling our name. Thank you for calling us out of the legions of demons of the world so that we may live in your light. Thank you for giving us this gift for salvation, for hope. And now, O Lord, may this bread and cup continually lift us up into your spiritual presence so that we will go forth from this place knowing that we are your beloved child. Amen. Friends, if you are able, please stand for the blessing today. With one hand, we remember that we receive God's blessing. With the other, we remind ourselves that we are also givers of God's blessing in the world. Friends, remember that you are a child of God, and that God's blessings are indeed upon you. You are made a new creation by the power of Christ, and we are made one family through the presence of the Holy Spirit. Let us go forth in love and peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Alleluia. Amen. We depart singing. Go now in peace.